You are watching College Football on ESPN, presented by Ally Bank. And today we are at Kid Brewer Stadium in Boone, North Carolina, for the Troy Trojans and the Mountaineers of Appalachian State. And a look at the Sun Belt standings shows that App State still in the hunt in the East with a 4-1 league mark. Troy comes into today's game with a 2-2 record. And we welcome you to Boone, North Carolina on this Saturday afternoon, along with Buckeye National Champion Dustin Fox. I'm Bill Roth for a battle of two teams that are traditional powers in the Sun Belt. In fact, Dustin, yep. They've combined to win 10 of the last 14 Sun Belt championships.
And both of these teams still have a lot to play for. You look at Troy, they still have a quarter of their season left to go. Aspirations of a bowl game. And for App State, even though they lost to Coastal Carolina last week, they can still win the conference.
Yeah, let's start with Appalachian today. And he's had a great career. Zach Thomas, the Appalachian quarterback, sensational career, but he's had a tough November.
29-5 as a starter here at App State. The last couple weeks, for whatever reason, just not himself. The miscues. I thought the pressure from the Chanticleers got to him, especially in the second half. You see the interception there. High throws. Just not the Zach Thomas that we've seen the last couple seasons here in Boone.
And today he's going up against a Troy defense that is dynamite and, in fact, is quite opportunistic.
No doubt about it. The last four games, this team, four defensive touchdowns. So we talk about Zach Thomas and some of those miscues. He better be on his A game this afternoon or Troy will make you pay.
Troy's got a great offense, but they come in leading the FBS in defensive touchdowns coming into this game today. And they've got two guys in the back end that are playing lights out.
Yeah, both Pettis and Stewart played a ton as freshmen a season ago. Now they're sophomores, growing up a little bit in the secondary. And we talked with the staff at Troy this week. They feel like these guys are going to be pretty darn good.
It is the Troy Trojans and the Appalachian State Mountaineers from Western North Carolina. Fun Belt in the Sun Belt. We've got the opening kickoff from Boone coming up next.
ESPN College Football is presented by Ally. Make your money work smarter with Ally and in part by Pizza Hut. Order today at pizzahut.com.
Kid Brewer Stadium, Boone, North Carolina. Troy and App State. Limited attendance here, but the fans that are in attendance today are fired up to see their Mountaineers in action. Now let's take a look at today's player spotlight brought to you by Ally Bank, and it is Demetrius Taylor of App State. He is a guy that can really take over a game up front.
And he took it over the last couple of weeks. I thought specifically a week ago against Coastal Carolina, he was unblockable at times. 19 and a half career sacks. And when we talk with the staff at App State, they rave about the way this guy plays with leverage.
Let's take a look at the coaching matchup. There's Chip Lindsey. He's in his second season at Troy, the former Auburn and Arizona State offensive coordinator who had COVID last week, and he's trying to come back. Told us he doesn't feel 100% just yet. He really respects everybody that's gone through COVID this year, but he's delighted to be off his couch and back on the sidelines for this game today. How hard is it to sit on your couch at home and watch your team play?
You don't get to see all the plays, but let's take a look at these keys for the game. I think for Troy, their quarterback, Gunnar Watson, has to get the football in the hands of his playmakers on the outside. And for App State, get back on track, Zach. That's what they need. They need the quarterback that's led this program to 29 victories.
App State won the toss, deferred to the second half, and the Mountaineers wearing all black today will kick things off. This is Riker Casey to get things underway. And here we go from Boone, and this is Kalen Geiger. The opening kick return for Troy, and he runs it out to about the 23-yard line, and that is where the Trojans will start on offense. We'll get our first look at their sophomore quarterback out of Butler, Georgia, Gunnar Watson. They're counting on him here today on the road.
Been a little bit banged up this season. A few weeks back, he fractured a couple of ribs and returned a week ago against Middle Tennessee, but just again, not the offensive performance that they expect here at Troy.
He's 37th nationally, averaging 243 yards a game. If you haven't watched the Trojans play this year, or under Lindsey, they like to throw the ball a ton. They started, however, on the ground today. And they got a yard or two on the first down carry.
They run a lot of up-tempo, try to get a lot of plays in, but when we chatted with Ryan Pugh, their offensive coordinator, it kind of feels like the up-tempo has been a bit of a bugaboo for their offense. It's been tough to get that thing going.
Javontez Woods is the starting tailback here today. Vidal is still out, and B.J. Smith's been battling a knee. They dump it off in the flat to Woods down the left sideline, and he's out near the 30.
And the one thing to keep an eye on early in this ballgame, the defense of App State. You've got a young quarterback in Gunnar Watson, just a sophomore, and boy, they are going to try and bring pressure. The Mountaineers are, especially in a situation like this.
Troy's about a 45% team on the year on third downs. They want to have some success early, particularly on the road against this team, which very rarely loses at home. Watson dumps it off to Woods, and the App defense is all over him. Boy, they are so well coached. They are so experienced. And there is Demetrius Taylor showing us why he's a guy to watch today in black.
Already involved early in the ball game. Just watch the speed of this defense. Taylor's on the outside. He runs it down. You've got multiple Mountaineers in pursuit of the football. That's what they do. That's how this defense has had so much success under defensive coordinator Dale Jones.
Jake Martin will punt the football away to App's Malik Williams, a dangerous punt returner. And it's a tremendous high punt. Williams going to call for the fair catch and take it back on his 28-yard line. All right, you had a chance to watch this App State offense last week. At times, in fact, they came out, they looked really good early. What happened?
Well, I just think in the second half, to be honest with you, their offensive line got a little worn out. Cam Peoples, who ran for a ton of yards in the first half, I think just got a little bit gassed. And certainly being on the road, Coastal Carolina had 5,500 fans. They were into it. They were loud. The home field advantage, I think, really helped Coastal down the stretch.
Peoples, number six, will start again today behind Zach Thomas, who is 29-5 as a starter. Only Trevor Lawrence has a better record among college starting quarterbacks. And Peebles, who had the big game last week, carries that one ahead to the 37-yard line, and there's the strong safety Pettis to knock him out of bounds. But that's a good, strong start for the Alabama native, Cameron Peebles.
The push from the offensive line. You know, Sean Clark is an offensive line coach by trade. They challenged the offensive line after that Georgia State game. They got to get pushed around a little bit. And Cameron Peoples, who's stepping up here because obviously Harrington's out for the season, he was terrific last week.
Out of the pistol, they're going to throw on second down and short. Thomas flips it behind the tight end Pearson, and it'll be third and one.
He could either ran the football here, take it off and just go, pick up the first down. But man, Billy, he had a wide open Malik Williams. Malik Williams was running wide open down the middle of the field against that quarter's coverage, and you know, Zach Thomas just didn't see it. Got to pull that trigger.
So third and one now for App, and they're among the nation's best, over 53% on third downs. Big hole up the middle, tremendous run, and App State scores on its first possession. A big play start for the Mountaineers and Cameron Peoples.
Now remember the great LaDainian Tomlinson used to say he loved when defenses would stack the box on third and one, fourth and one, because a lot of times these teams get out of one gap and that's when the home run hits happen. And that's exactly what happened right there with the App State offensive line and for Cam Peoples to make the house call.
It's a 63-yard run for Peebles, and App State takes the early lead, 7-0, less than 3 minutes into the game. It's his sixth touchdown of the year. What a huge hole he had as they stacked the box. Peebles did the rest.
This is what the coach talked about, challenging the offensive line, and right there, they get it done.
App State takes the 7-0 lead on the 63-yard run by sophomore tailback Cameron Peoples, the Alabama native. What happened, Dustin?
Watch the center here. That's Noah Hannon. He's going to get a great kickout block right here on 31. That's Pettis right there. Boom. And because he gets that block, you're going to watch Peoples slide through. Pettis can't make the tackle, and he's in the end zone.
and a 7-0 App State lead, and that's the start that they were looking for after the way that game ended last week on the road. Second kickoff of the quarter, and a touchback. It'll be a fair catch. So last week, for those that don't know, App State, they had the lead the final couple of minutes on the road last week, and then it got away from them at the end at Coastal.
Really, the score was not indicative of how the game had gone. I mean, this was, look, they App had the lead, 23-21, with 2.5 to go.
Right.
I mean, so obviously, it could have gone either way. Coastal just got it done late in the fourth quarter.
And so Sean Clark's team gets going first. Now let's see how Troy responds. Gunnar Watson and company with their second offensive series of the game, and they'll start from the 25. And again, Woods is the lone back.
You got a false start, maybe.
Yeah, I thought they started early on the right side of that offensive line, and the whistles will kill the play. And this will be a procedure call, one would assume, on Troy.
False start. 77, offense. 5-yard penalty. Replay. First down.
They call that on Derek Graham. He is the right tackle. You saw him take a step early. By the way, his father, Derek Sr., played here at App State, then 9 years in the NFL. So this is a big game for Graham to play on the same field with his different team. His dad played for App, and he, of course, starts at right tackle for Troy. So first and 15 now for Watson. They try to keep it on the ground to Woods, and he gets, about a half a yard. Demetrius Taylor again making the snap.
Well, it's a team that really doesn't beat themselves. Just 1.9 penalties per 100 offensive plays. That's pretty good.
Second and 14. App's going to go with a nickel defense here. In fact, we may see a lot of that today. This is a team that loves to throw the football, is Troy. Watson a half roll to the right, and he completes that pass for a short gain of 4, and it's going to bring up third down and 11. McLean with the catch.
So this is a down here now. Third and long with the young quarterback. This is where Dale Jones is going to try to light up Gunnar Watson. When I say that, I'm talking pressure. Not just a 4-5 man pressure. They'll bring 6. So you've got more hats inside the box. Gunner's going to have to get rid of the football rather quickly, I'm guessing.
They'll call it third down and 11 for Watson. He does get it out of there quick to Geiger. And he gets ahead to the 27-yard line. And the App defense, 2-3 and outs to start the game. That's an encouraging start for Dale Jones and the App State defense here today.
I just love the pursuit of the football. This is a defensive lineman. This is Caleb Sperling on the edge, running down the line on a jailbreak screen, essentially. He makes the tackle. That's the effort that you want to see if you're Dale Jones. I thought it was fascinating. We did the App Monroe game earlier this season, and that was when they had missed 21 days of nothing, basically. Come back, they had 0 missed tackles in that game.
Another good punt. Malik Williams, another fair catch to the 28-yard line, and that is where App State will take over. 5 minutes in on this Saturday in Boone, North Carolina, and App State with a 7-0 lead. App State, a 7-0 lead here in the first quarter at Kid Brewer Stadium. Coming up tonight at 7 on ESPN and the App. Boy, this should be good. Freshman quarterback T.J. Finley leads LSU to College Station to take on quarterback Kellen Mond and the number 5 Aggies, who are still in playoff contention. They're going to make an impression on the committee. LSU at Texas A&M. Dustin.
Should be a good one. And remember, last year Mond was not very good in that game. They got thrashed 50-7, so maybe a little payback tonight.
Sean Clark, head coach at Appalachian State. This guy is living the dream. 45-year-old Charleston, West Virginia native, played here, was an assistant coach here, and now the head coach at his alma mater.
I don't think he ever wants to leave Boone again, by the way. He's pretty content.
First down running play, and they stack the box, and this time they're able to gang up on Nate Noel, the freshman from Miami's Northwestern High School. That was Pierce that got in there. They can be really, really good up front, can Troy, and they're going to load the box up today.
Well, they're going to have to against this beefy offensive line and running attack of App State. They're going to have to get in there. They're going to have to do what Georgia State did and what Marshall did earlier this season and what Coastal did a little bit last week. You have 8-9 guys in the box, and you have to make throws on the outside.
Second and 14. Thomas does throw to the outside in traffic and threads the needle beautifully. Is it a catch? You bet it is. Sensational grab over there by Malik Williams as quarterback Zach Thomas threads the needle.
And this is going to be between two defenders, and a throw like this can really build a quarterback's confidence. It's between Pettis right there, you see coming underneath. Does a great job with the concentration. And remember, Fletcher, Bill, is, you know, something we'll talk about, is filling in for probably the best corner on that Troy defense. Terrence Dunlap's out today.
And so Fletcher, the sophomore from Huntsville, is starting on that side. They keep it on the ground on this first down play, and Noel crosses midfield ahead to the 49-yard line of Troy. Noel is probably the smallest back on the App team, but he potentially is the most explosive. He was brought down by Jaden McDonald.
I mean, he was a state champ in high school, in the 4x400-meter relay team. He's got some speed. And they like his versatility to be able to kind of be that change of pace back to Cam Peoples.
There goes Malik Williams in motion. A throw for Thomas. Fires, and it is complete to Virgil. And that'll be another first down ahead of the 32-yard line of Troy. First catch of the day for the Lawrenceville, Georgia native, who's been dinged up a bit this year. But he makes this catch from Thomas.
And early in the game, they're going at Fletcher. Go at him again on this back-to-back play.
Virgil this time brings it inside the 16. They'll move it to the 15-yard line. Back-to-back catches for Jalen Virgil, and the Mountaineers going quick here. No huddle. From the 15-yard line, Thomas to the right, flips it short. Malik Williams, the catch and the score. Touchdown, Appalachian. What a drive that was for Appalachian State and Zach Thomas.
I think that Coach Sean Clark is probably thinking, where was that drive in the fourth quarter when we needed to go down and try to win the football game against Coastal? But no, Billy, that was a terrific, well-managed drive by Zach Thomas. He was efficient, and I think because he made some throws, and certainly making the throws on the run, this is where he's at his best. Moving outside the pocket, and then Williams does the rest, finds the end zone, all App State early. And Thomas, he's got his groove back.
Quick start for App State on its home field. Two possessions, two touchdowns. Trying to bounce back after last week's loss at Coastal. They're up to a 14-0 lead. Malik Williams with that touchdown reception. Riker Casey will kick the football back to Troy for the third time here in this first half. And that'll be a fair catch called for Troy. Let's check in the studio now. Here's Kevin Connors. All right, Kevin, thanks. Troy trying to answer after falling behind 14-0. Watson thought maybe taking a deep shot. Instead, he misfires, throwing it behind the running back, Woods. All right, what happened on the touchdown here, Dusty?
Williams here. Williams going to come all the way across the formation, but watch these linebackers. They stare in the backfield the entire play, and as he comes across the formation, gets stuck right there, and he's wide open for the touchdown. Comes a long way across that formation.
You know, last week in visiting with Coach Hall, the defensive coordinator, and the Troy people, they had 17 busts on the first 43 plays against Middle Tennessee. Just plays that the guys make in practice, but they didn't make last week, at least in the first half.
Well, and remember, they were down how many guys with COVID issues, contact tracing, what have you, a week ago. So he had a lot of fresh faces on that defense. They expect to play better. Remember, they beat Middle Tennessee in week one. 47-14.
Yeah. Troy still looking for its initial first down of the game. This is third down and four. And that's picked off. Beautifully done. Jumping the route and a pick six. Touchdown, Appalachian. Steven Jones runs it in for the score.
Talk about the perfect start. Getting that sick taste out of your mouth from that loss at Coastal Carolina. Offense clicking, defense clicking. We talked about the opportunistic defense that Troy has. Now early in the ball game, the Mountaineers taking it to Troy.
And the extra point makes it 21-0. Well, they thought that Watson would be the key guy today. They needed him to make good decisions and execute. What happened here?
Oh, the quarterback stares down his route and throws it behind the receiver. That's what good cornerbacks do. Stares it down and then watch Jones. Gets his hands on the football. A lot of times, DBs, they make fun of him. They say, well, there's a reason you play defense. He looked like a wide receiver right there, and he knows what to do with it by taking it to the house for this App State defense.
So Jones runs it in 4-6, and now Watson has to have a very short memory, doesn't he? After the situation they're in now, down 21-0, we have not played 8 minutes of this first quarter, Dusty.
Yeah, and in last week he had the two picks. Coming into that portion of the season, because remember, he missed the time with the ribs. He had only thrown three interceptions the first part of the season. So now he's got three in two games, back to back.
And the kick through the end zone. And so now the Troy offense, which has yet to pick up a first down, will try it again, down 21-0. All right, let's take a look at this week's college football playoff rankings. They're brought to you by Allstate. And there we go. The Iron Bowl underway.
It's big news right there for the Buckeyes.
And Ohio State canceled.
That'll be very interesting to see what happens with the committee here going forward with the COVID cancellations.
You seem to feel that even if Ohio State hypothetically doesn't play in the Big Ten championship game because of that league's rules on having a minimum of six games, you say the committee would say, well, they're still one of the top four.
I think they'll still have a chance. Would they deserve it? Probably not. But you still have to, as a committee, put the top four teams in the college football playoff, and you'll say to yourself, is Ohio State better than a Northwestern? Are they better than a Cincinnati? That's the question that the committee will have to answer.
That'll be fun on Tuesday night to dive more into that after the cancellation. Boy, Troy just can't get any push up front. The App defense just continues to dominate in the middle.
You know what's so funny, too, is this push is all happening without George Blackstock. That's one of your top nose guards. He's missed now back-to-back games. The player's stepping up behind him. There you take a look at good-looking cornerback Nick Hampton. Does a good job shooting his gun and making that play.
They're still looking for their first down of the day. And it's not going to come now. Once again, Gene Charles does an amazing job of getting people on the ground. The ball was thrown nicely to Woods, and Gene Charles chops him down. It's fourth down again.
You know, he plays the boundary corner position. That means you play to the short side of the field. The reason you play a certain corner in that spot is because they're more physical. They're one of your better tacklers on the team. I can attest. I played boundary corner
right.
at Ohio State, right? You make a lot of plays. You get a lot of run action to you, and that's why they love Gene Charles there playing that boundary. It's not that he can't cover, but he's just probably the most physical corner that they've got.
Future pro as well. The fair catch was called for. They collide with Williams, the return man.
Is that a live ball?
It might be.
There's
Did
no
someone
flag.
Touch it? No, they're just going to say it's down on the 3-yard line.
And you've got a Troy player down right at the point of contact. Bill, how was that not a flag for kick catch interference?
It is possible the officials are going to rule that the App State player pushed the Troy player into him.
He's blocked into him. He was, absolutely. So does this hit an App player? That's the question.
If
There's
it does.
No kick catch interference. The player was blocked into the receiver.
Oh, my goodness. It may have hit the back.
First down.
It may have hit the back of Tucker.
If not, it will simply go as a 66-yard punt as they tend to the injured Troy player here.
What do you think? Do you think that it hit Tucker?
I don't know, but they will review the play.
For sure.
We'll get another look. So he gets blocked into the return man, thus that is not a foul.
Yeah. I don't think it hit an App State player in black. I think that that's probably just going to be a great punt. So something good happens for Troy as you get to pin back the Mountaineers offense.
So they flip the field and they'll start on their own 3-yard line. Peebles straight ahead running. Gets about 7 to about the 10-yard line. That's actually Marcus Williams Jr., his first touch of the day, the senior from Rocky Mount, North Carolina. Remember, Daytrick Harrington, their junior, is out with a knee. Williams has been banged up. That was his first carry in a couple of weeks. Williams again gets ahead to the 12-yard line. It'll be third down and short. And boy, there is nothing that Brandon Hall and Troy and that defense wouldn't need more right now than a stop, try to get the ball back with some better field position.
Well, I'll tell you, in a situation like this, this offensive line, the veteran offensive line of App State, they get excited for these moments. You know, on the goal line, fourth and one. You know, these are the moments where the offensive line, Sean Clark's guys, have to step up.
Third and one, and it's close, but I do think he got it. It is right at the marker, and it will be a first down for Marcus Williams. Richard Jabarnor making the tackle, but it will be a first down just across the 13-yard line.
Well, I thought that right there in the middle of that defense, Will Cholo, their great defensive tackle, takes on a double team and nearly gets the stop for the Trojans.
Thomas, the throw on first down, has room to run, has the first down and slides in nicely just shy of the 27-yard line. A little pop-up slide, too, for Zach. That will get you an A-plus from the App State baseball coach.
Does a good job. Doesn't force a throw. Kind of thought it was a little bit of a busted play early because he looks off to his left for the play action as the running back there and then decides to just take off and run for the first down. Really good decision for Zach Thomas.
That's a gain of about 3. A flag is on the play. Let's go to the studio once again. Here's Kevin. All right, Kevin, thanks. They're doing that.
Defense, number two, 15-yard penalty added into the run. First down.
Alabama's playing without its head coach, Coach Saban, watching. That's exactly what Chip Lindsey had to do last week for Troy. What happened on this play? Focus in on it here, Dusty.
Yeah, just going to get a little bit too much.
So the drive started on the 3 and has moved out to the 46 now here in this first quarter, one that App State has completely dominated. Here is Peebles. Look at the yards after contact. He ends up getting about 8 or perhaps even 9 yards, is this sophomore from Alabama playing against his home state school, Troy. It'll be 2nd and 2.
What's the cutback by Peebles? Right there. It's a jump cut. It's that R1 button on the PlayStation, and he just burst through that hole. This is really where he left off last week. You know, his first half was tremendous against Coastal.
We can tell you have kids.
I'm still a kid, Bill.
You still play it?
I play a lot of video games.
Here's Hennigan with the catch, his first of the day, and that'll be enough for the first down. Ahead of the 42-yard line, the senior from Greensboro, Thomas Hennigan.
Hennigan's playing with a really significant hamstring injury. Not the player that he was a season ago, but he's still gutting through. And they're running a lot more short routes with Hennigan, and that's where he's having his success.
Here's a reverse to Malik Williams. They got this one sniffed out, and they throw him down for a loss of about 3 yards on the play. That right there, that's the best play of the day for Troy's defense, and a nice job by the secondary. And Darryl Starling, who they tell us put on quite a show at dinner the other night in Thanksgiving dinner, number 19 in white.
Yeah, he could put down some food now. And really good job by the defense playing with discipline, staying at home. And App State tried to set that up 2 plays ago. They ran the same motion, but they just faked the reverse, and they come back to it here. And Troy was not fooled at all.
On 2nd and long, Thomas to throw. And he throws behind the tight end, Pearson. I'm not sure who was even open on the play. And it'll be 3rd down.
Yeah, that was kind of strange. He kind of throws it off of his back foot. The footwork here is just off. Look, kind of falling away. I think he felt the pressure. We talked about that in the open, how much pressure
he
received over the last couple of weeks. That forced those balls against Coastal to kind of sail on him. And you saw it right there. He's got to settle in. And he didn't have pressure. He had time to set his feet, plant, and make that throw.
Final minute of the first. It's 3rd down and 12 for App State. 5 receiver formation. Wide open is Malik Williams again for the first down inside the 25-yard line.
Malik Williams is really starting to come into his own, and they need him. The senior kind of did it all in high school, but making some plays on the outside.
Thomas did not throw left, throws right, and gets a couple of yards. Let's go back to the previous play when Thomas had time, stepped into this throw, and it was a beauty.
Yeah, just a deep dig right into the zone, soft coverage there. There's not a Troy defender within 4 yards. That's an easy throw for the first down, and I don't know why Troy was playing so soft there in 3rd and long.
Into the first quarter.
App State dominates the opening quarter here at home. Mountaineers here at Kid Brewer Stadium, a.k.a. The Rock, with a 21-0 lead over the Troy Trojans here in Boone. We go to quarter number 2 here in Boone, North Carolina. Appalachian State with the 3-touchdown lead and on the move again. 2nd down inside the 30-yard line. It's 2nd and 9 for Zach Thomas, who's been nearly perfect today. Takes a shot at the end zone. It is caught by Hennigan. Touchdown, Appalachian.
Well, you could tell this was a bust. Jaden McDonald and Craig Slocum, the free safety, are kind of staring at each other, putting their hands up. Hey, man, what happened? That was too easy. And give a lot of credit to the offensive line of App State because they created a beautiful pocket to allow Zach Thomas to step up and deliver the football.
Staten has been perfect already today on extra points, and that makes it 28-0.
Great job. Look at the amount of time Zach Thomas has, and he's got a wide open receiver and blowing this game wide open as well.
Thanksgiving break time here in Boone, North Carolina at Appalachian State University. Limited attendance, which is the rule nationwide, and only 7% allowed in the state of North Carolina. So just about 1,200 people here today. Another kickoff and another touchback for App State. Let's go to the studio again. Kevin Connors. All right, Kevin, thank you. Here, Troy trying to make something good happen, looking for their first down of the game. Jamontez Woods, the carry, got about 4 yards on the play. All right, let's look at the touchdown that made it 28-0.
How's Hennigan so wide open? He's going to run just a little post. This is your safety right here, Craig Slocum. They're in quarters coverage. He's supposed to take the route. He doesn't. He bites on the outside route, and Hennigan's wide open.
Hennigan and Thomas for the last couple of years have been such a great pass catch combo here at App State. Like Luke Combs, the App State grad, would say, they are better together, right?
Like good old boys and beer, as Luke would say.
Thomas is better when Hennigan's healthy, and Hennigan's better when
I like your
Thomas
play
is
on,
throwing it.
Play on the lyrics of Luke Combs, the alum of App State. Sure he's watching somewhere.
Ineligible receiver downfield, number one, Troy. 5-yard penalty, previous spot. Replay the down.
Somehow, Geiger gets called for being an ineligible receiver downfield, which means he just lined up wrong.
Covered somebody up.
Right. So what is happening to Troy here in this first half here today?
You talked about the miscues they had a week ago. I think it was pre-snap. Got to be aware where you're at on the field.
So second down and 11 now for Watson and Troy. There's a big hole and the biggest gain of the day for Woods. And they'll move the sticks.
Well, this thing opened up beautifully on the inside. Look at the double team right there on Sperlin. And that's going to open up a big hole. And really the best offensive play they've had all day.
It was 28-0 before Troy got a first down. Here's Woods again. And he gets a couple. Again, B.J. Smith has the knee injury. Vidal is out. They're really shorthanded from a running game perspective. That was Nick Hampton, by the way, that made the tackle again against this shorthanded Troy offense.
He's looking forward to seeing Vidal. Very talented, true freshman running back here in the Sun Belt.
Watson out of Butler, Georgia, hands it off again to Woods, and the Mountaineers push him back. They get a good surge up front. That was Cobb coming up really as an inside linebacker, reading it, making a terrific play.
Look at the push here on the outside, just not allowing the running back to get to the edge. Nowhere to go. And now a big third and seven coming up here for this App State defense. And again, a situation where you like to bring pressure. And you saw Gunnar Watson early in this ballgame, the pressure kind of getting to him a little bit.
They bring the nickel, Steven Jones, in once again. Remember, he had a pick six earlier in this game. This time they dump it short to Woods. He's got the first down across the 50. And for the first time today, the Trojans are in App territory. Ahead to the 46-yard line, Caden Smith made the play.
And now going with a little bit of that up-tempo. It's always important to get those first downs, and then you can go. You get the momentum going, get going downfield, take a shot.
They go fast, a beautiful throw over the middle to Clark. He's got the first down inside the 25-yard line. So Troy fans might be saying, why isn't Ryan Pugh going fast all the time?
Because they haven't had a lot of the success on the earlier downs. And when you don't, what you do is you put your defense in a bad spot. You punt the football, and they have to go back on the field.
Three completions in a row. That one was to Todd, and he's out of bounds near the 20-yard line. All of a sudden, it is as if the alarm clock went off for Troy.
Yeah, the light bulb has gone off for this Troy offense the last, what, five snaps? And now all of a sudden you're seeing some substitution issues here late for the App State defense with the tempo. You want to get some fresh bodies in there on the defensive line. Now they're going to get him in there. And Troy's going to try to go as fast as they can.
In the red zone for the first time today.
And some confusion on App State's defense.
Ball gets ahead of the 17-yard line. Brandon Harrington again making the play defensively. It's going to be third down and about four now for Troy.
This is only a play that one guy can make. That's Harrington. He's sitting there from his outside linebacker position. And once that hole opens up, they always say shoot your gun, right? Go get it right now. When you see it, believe it, and go make the stop.
They need to get just across the 15-yard line for the first down. Watson hands it off once again.
Great effort.
That's the first touch of the day for DK Billingsley, and he's got the first down.
You see the first four drives, not very good. This drive, it looks like a completely different offense. I'm sure that Coach Chip Lindsey's pretty happy with the way this offense looks. I mean, this guy, you know, he's known for offense. They did last season, what he's done at Auburn as a coordinator, and now coming here, he's got to start over with a young quarterback, have some growing pains, but he does like the upside of Gunnar Watson.
The tight end Lewis lines up on the right. They run the ball back to the left, and the tailback stumbles.
You
does
know who
Smith.
The Turf Monster.
First touch of the day for B.J. Smith, who's been
right,
battling a knee. And
yeah, gets him a little right there, and he knows it. And his teammates will not let that go when they have the meetings after the ball game.
Second and nine for the Trojans.
Smith stays in the game. He was the preseason Sun Belt Offensive Player of the Year last year, was Smith. Spins off a tackle and gets inside the 10-yard line. And it'll be third down from near the nine for B.J. Smith, fifth-year guy. He's out of Millbrook, Alabama. Dawkins made the play for App. Third and six now for Troy.
This is the matchup I love up here at the top. It's this corner. That's Gene Charles. And the top receiver is McLean. Let's see if they decide to test the great corner.
Watson looking left the whole way, throws that way, and it's out of the corner of the end zone. That's Reggie Todd, the intended receiver. Good drive, comes up short, and at this point, Chip Lindsey says, let's get some points.
I think you got to take the points just from a confidence standpoint. Watch his eyes here on this play. Stares right over there to his left the entire time, and you got to give yourself a chance.
Evan Legassi is the junior place kicker. 27-yarder. He is just 7 of 14 on the year. But he puts that one right down the middle. And Troy gets on the board. And that is a victory after falling behind 28-0. A sign of life for Chip Lindsey and Troy on the board here in Boone. Well, kick off your week 12 NFL Sunday at 10 a.m. Eastern with the Countdown crew on ESPN and the app. They'll have all the early breaking stories, injury updates, and preview each game right up to kickoff. 28-3, App has the lead, a victory of sorts, maybe mentally more so than anything else now for Troy. After falling behind 28-0, they didn't have a single first down till that possession.
I think it was a win to get the offense going, but still you settle for three. You're down four touchdowns so early in the ball game. Obviously you had to get some points in that situation, but you hope they can build off of that momentum from the offensive drive right there.
Kickoff return down the sideline, and that's Jones that gets knocked out of bounds after crossing the 40. Let's go back to the studio and check in again with Kevin Connors. Wow, how about those Clemson Tigers? Well, you get going on the home field, you get some turnovers, and that's what's happened here for App State as well. Thomas taking a deep shot from Malik Williams, and it's broken up near the 15-yard line. Good play at the very last second by Kyle Nixon.
Yeah, this is really good discipline by Nixon at the end of this play. The ball a little bit underthrown by Thomas because he has to kind of turn around for it, but watch the concentration and frankly, as I watch that back, more of a drop for, you know, by Williams there. Nixon was there, but still, that ball could have been caught.
App State's been perfect today offensively. Here's Noel running to the left. They have not been stopped. You throw in the defensive touchdown, and that's how you get to the 28 quick points. That's a pickup of five or so, and it'll bring up a third down and five.
I'm still waiting for App State to run a trick play. You know, they're known for that. We had them in the UL Monroe game. They run a flea flicker. I know that Coach Sean Clark's got a lot of that stuff up his sleeve, and this is kind of the area of the field where you want to take those opportunities.
Deshaun Davis, who they're really high on, he's a freshman, goes in motion wide to the left of the top of your screen. They throw it to Davis. And he's got the first down. That was a heady play. Reaches forward, stretching the ball to the 49.
It was. A lot of times receivers in those situations will catch the pass and almost go backwards to try and get more yardage. But you're right, very heady play right there because he knew right where the stick was at. The full extension gets the first down.
He's one of those many South Florida players that are starring for App. He's from Deerfield Beach in Broward County.
Your neck of the woods, Billy.
A lot of preps. Stars down there. Keeping it on the ground again, Noel. You see how quick he is. He's got a little wiggle, and he gets ahead to the 38-yard line.
Isn't he just the perfect complement to Cam Peoples? Kind of get used to Peoples running downhill with his big frame, and then all of a sudden Noel comes in. Just a little shifty jitterbug in there. It's a push by the offensive line. Love their combination.
Stewart brought him down on that play, and here comes the App offense again. Noel ahead to the 25-yard line. K.J. Robertson, the tackle on that play. This is App State's version of going tempo now. Out of the pistol, Thomas to let it go. And the intended receiver there was the tight end Pearson. And that'll stop the clock with 6:24 to go in this first half that Appalachian State has dominated. To be honest, App State, since joining the Sun Belt, has dominated in so many ways. Sean Clark trying to lead this team to its fifth straight Sun Belt Conference champion. They've won the league 4 years in a row. That's a bad snap. And a procedure call. The flags and whistles kill the play.
False start. Offense. Number 5. 5-yard penalty. Replay. Second down.
Looked on the play that Thomas might not have been ready, and maybe the snap just came early. Watch, he's looking to his right, and there came the ball right back from center Noah Hannon. So it'll be second and very long. They'll call it second and 15 officially, back near the 30. A play fake for Thomas. The pressure comes. Thomas to Noel. It's underthrown and nearly picked by Reddy Stewart. Had the ball in his hands. Reddy Stewart read this beautifully,
yeah.
Didn't he?
You talked about Reddy Stewart in the open. That is just a dropped INT. And I think that Zach Thomas was just about a half second late on that throw. He had his target wide open.
Third down and 15 from the 30 for Thomas and App State. Quick screen to the left side to Davis. Has to make a man miss, but nice job to get him on the ground by O'Shea Fletcher. Remember, Fletcher starting in place of Terrence Dunlap, who's out today. And the sophomore from Huntsville makes a perfect open field tackle.
That's a beautiful play by the corner filling in. Open field tackles are not easy. And that's well done by Fletcher.
This will be a 42-yard attempt for Chandler State and the senior place kicker out of Gainesville, Florida. 8 of 12 on the season. As long as 45. This is from 42 yards away. And does he sneak it in? Yep, inside that left upright. So Staten connects his 9th field goal of the year, and App extends its lead to 31-3.
So it's still kind of a win, though, right, for Troy? Hadn't stopped them all game, holding them to a field goal. Now let's see if that offense can come back with that momentum they had there.
Back in Boone, App State leading 31-3. Back in black. Back in all black for App State today. They've got the big lead and another touchback. Troy State.
A lot of action here after
flags
the play
on the field.
Multiple flags, Bill.
Well, the boys are getting a little feisty from Troy, getting down 31-3 on the road. They're tired of returning kicks today.
I would be too.
It was the 6th kickoff of the first half.
They want to start kicking off.
Holding. Return team, number 28. It's a 10-yard penalty. First down.
And you see Coach Lindsay just throw his hands in the air going, man, it has been Murphy's Law out there today. A hold on a touchback. I mean, what are the odds of that?
And for a team that really does not commit a lot of penalties, look at the drive chart today, Billy. The last drive was very efficient.
They did not have a first down until their last possession, which resulted in the field goal. Let's see how they do now. They've got 5.5 minutes to go. They went quick. Gunnar Watson, the young man from Butler, Georgia. That's about 2 hours south of Atlanta. Completed at one point 4 in a row on that drive. He connects with Geiger, who caught it and fell. That could have been a big gain. Instead, it just gets...
Wow, he catches this.
He didn't catch it.
If he catches this and turns around, Nicholas Ross, the strong safety, he's like playing 15 yards off, and he was nowhere in the picture. That would have been, I'm guessing, at least a first down pickup.
That's caught, and that's a first down to Khalil McClain out to the 37-yard line. When he has time to throw, Watson can throw a nice football.
Boy, watch him step into this throw. That is a beautiful throw by Gunnar Watson. It has to have that zip on it. Otherwise, that's going to be intercepted. Tight window. Well done.
Big hole up the middle for Woods. He's got the first down across the 50-yard line. They head to the 48-yard line. And here comes Troy's tempo.
This is what they want. They want to get those first downs on the early downs. It allows them to get up to the ball quickly, try to catch the defense off guard.
Deep shot. He's got his man. That's Todd. And a flag is thrown. That'll be a pass interference penalty against App State. McLean running down the sideline against Jones. McLean hobbles back to the bench.
Pass interference. Defense. Number 12. 15-yard penalty. First down.
It's almost like a double coverage here, bracketed, but you watch Jones come in. He gets the hands across the body early. That's what's going to draw the call. And he gets up and he knows he's going to get the call. McLean, dude, I can't catch the ball. He's all over me. Obviously, a very obvious pass interference call.
Moving to the 33-yard line of App State. Watson escapes the initial heat, lets it go. It's caught by Geiger. Touchdown, Troy.
Now that is what Chip Lindsey's offense is expected to look like. Efficient, down the field, big chunk plays. Do have a flag, I think, in the end zone here. But I think this is going to be against the defense. Or is he just picking it up?
There's no foul on the play. The result of the play is a touchdown.
33-yard touchdown reception to Geiger, the senior from Fort Worth, Texas. It's his second of the season.
Geiger was a JUCO transfer, really stormed on the scene, you know, last year. And he said, we talked with Coach Ryan Pugh, he said, Geiger's the guy you want to take in backyard football. Loves the game. This is how you respond if you are the Troy Trojans. Watson getting back on track and maybe getting Troy back in the game. 31-10 from Boone. Well, how did Geiger get so wide open? Here's Geiger right here in the slot. He's going to run all the way across the field. Safety right here is in quarters coverage. That means he's got to match up with Geiger. And as it runs, you'll see right here, he bites. Right here, he bites. And now he's out of position. And great job by Gunnar Watson getting outside the pocket. And you got yourself 6 points.
Kalen Geiger gives a lot of credit to his mom for raising him. He has lived his life without his dad, who's been in prison since Kalen was just 3 years old. His dad's going to be released in 2022. They do stay in great contact, though. His dad is still in his life. He's looking forward to them rejoining the family. This will go as another touchback, and it sends us back to the studio to Kevin. Great career at Alabama. Zach Thomas, kind of similar. Seemingly knows exactly what the coaches want. He's almost an extension of the coach on the field.
You know, that's kind of cliche when we talk about that.
Uh-huh.
But there's some truth to that. When the coach has the faith in the quarterback on the field to make the decisions, it makes it a lot easier on the coach. Confidence.
It helps when you've got seniors out there like Hennigan that seemingly runs the best route all the time. But Thomas and Hennigan, they've been throwing the ball back and forth to each other for 4 years here.
It's a great combination, and really, it's kind of unfortunate that Hennigan's not 100% healthy this year. They cut his routes down. Everything's 5 to 10 yards, intermediate at best. He could be a deep threat too, but because that hamstring's bothering him, they're not making him run down the field. Just doesn't quite have that burst.
You see he wears that C on his chest. He's one of the captains. Flags before the play again. They were going to fake the reverse, but instead the penalty.
False start. Offense, number 70, 5-yard penalty. Replay, second down.
Cooper Hodges is the sophomore right tackle.
Boy, they're glad to have him back on this offensive line. He missed the Georgia State game with injury, so they had to move over Cole Garrison from left tackle to right tackle, and they felt it in that game. Mm-hmm. Not having his experience on that right side was huge, having him back against Coastal.
Here's Peebles got a bit of a run, rather Williams, and that'll be enough for the first down. The thing you got to remember about App, App's only lost two games this year, but both teams that beat him are undefeated,
right?
Marshall and Coastal Carolina.
Yeah, both those teams ranked inside the top 25. And fans are looking, saying, man, why are we not, you know, getting more consistent play or whatnot? And they are. I mean, they're 6-2. Goodness. This is a team that nearly had a win, upset win, on the road a week ago.
Peebles gets tripped on the left side. Fletcher got a hand in there to bring him down. And it'll be second down.
As you watch the clock kind of tick down here in the second quarter, so crucial for the Troy defense to get off the field. Obviously, they're going to get the football to start the second half.
Appalachian State is.
Excuse me, yeah. So they don't want to App to get the football and continue to add the points. They're racking them up at this point is what I'm trying to say. So it's vital for Troy to try and get the ball back and get something going before halftime.
Quick throw. And that's Malik Williams. He's going to be brought down shy of the first down again. That was Del Pettis that brought him down. And a chance now for this Troy defense to get off the field. It's going to be third and two.
Now this is where your defensive front really needs to bow up against that App State veteran offensive group. Of course, they get in that heavy package with the two tight ends up top of your screen.
Virgil goes in motion. Thomas going to throw it. It's caught by Peebles, and he steps out of bounds after picking up the first down at the 49.
A lot of work to just get about 3.5 yards to pick up the first down. The little window dressing with the motion to come back, all the misdirection, and you basically roll it out, and Thomas has an option to run that too, but just dumps it off for the first down.
Final 2 minutes of the first half. Peebles tried to keep it alive, but uh-uh. That is Shaquel Brown that grabbed him around the ankle and would not let go.
Peebles is not easy to get on the ground. That's a pretty impressive tackle by Brown.
Brown was shaken up on the play. You see he goes over to the bench after making that play. Clock is turning under 90 seconds to go. They'll go with an empty backfield now as Noel, the running back, lines up wide left. Thomas to the air, throws it behind Williams, who one-handed bobbled, caught it, and then runs ahead for three and a timeout taken. Malik Williams had to reach out with his left hand and bat that pass to himself.
You know, that was kind of an easy throw.
Timeout on the field. Let's go to the studio. Here's Kevin Connors. Kevin, looking forward to hearing you and Jim coming up at the break.
He mentions Western New York.
Yes.
What Jarrett Patterson did today.
Amazing.
In Maction was unbelievable. This kid runs for eight touchdowns. Eight. The double Al Bundy.
Think he's going to get a helmet sticker tonight?
I think he'll get a helmet sticker tonight and may get a few more helmet stickers from Lance Whitehead, their coach there at Buffalo. By the way, 406 yards on the ground.
I think we know who the MAC Offensive Player of the Week is going to be.
I think so.
Third down, they convert. Once again, there's Hennigan. And he gets ahead to the 36-yard line as we approach the one-minute mark. They'll stop the clock to move the sticks at 105.
Now, this is perfect for App State. You've got plenty of time. Still have two timeouts left. This is where Zach Thomas really can thrive. He did this last week at the end of the first half as well. Went 51 seconds for a touchdown.
Thomas on the run, fires, and he threw it incomplete inside the 20-yard line to Malik Williams, who was in a crowd. Pettis had the coverage on the play. Well, our Week 12 Monday Night Football matchup is a battle of the birds. Russell Wilson, DK Metcalf lead the NFC West leading Seahawks into Philadelphia to take on the Eagles and Carson Wentz. 8 Eastern, 5 Pacific. ESPN, ESPN Deportes, and the ESPN app. Coverage begins with Monday Night Countdown at 6.
You know, my first ever NFL game was on Monday Night Football.
Is that right?
Yeah.
How'd you play?
Not bad.
Thomas, the heady senior, throws that one away.
Got my first tackle.
On Monday Night Football?
Yeah. It's the Green Bay Packers.
Well, if you're joining us late in the first quarter, it was all App. They jumped out to a 21-0 lead and dominated. Second quarter, the folks in Troy are saying, that's what I'm talking about. That's how we can play.
The offense got going with the tempo. But it was really Gunnar Watson making the big throws and then getting up, kind of changing the balance of it, running the football and passing it. Getting the chunk plays in the tempo helped a ton.
They need to get to the 26 for a first down. The heat comes. Thomas fires wide open. Malik Williams has the first down to the 10-yard line. Oh, Zach Thomas took a hit, but he delivered the pass to Malik Williams.
Yeah, he's one of the toughest players you're going to find in college football. Now he's just going to get up to the line of scrimmage, spike it. We assume, as some teams do the fake spike. You never know. We saw Western Michigan earlier this year.
And now we have a flag on the play. Here's the play before.
Look at him step up there.
Illegal substitution. Defense. 12 men on the play at the snap. First down. 5-yard
penalty.
What's
the hit? Sometimes they call that as a late hit. And his center, Noah Hannon right there, saw it and kind of goes into a little defense mode for his quarterback.
Ball's on the 6 with 28 seconds left after the penalty. It will be 1st and 5 on the 6. There's not a lot of time left in the half, just 28 seconds, but they can get a first down on the 1. Out of the pistol. Thomas looking right, a fade to Hennigan, and he threw it away. Nicely done. Thomas Hennigan was covered, and it'll be 2nd and 5 on the 6. That is Howard's Knob, which is located here in Boone, North Carolina. That's the high point of Watauga County.
Yeah.
That might be Ash County. That might be the county next door.
I'm told that mansion,
5 yards
top
penalty.
Of
replay.
The mountain is for sale.
Second down.
It's not cheap, and I know our director, Mike Roth, is in the market for a mansion. He wants it. For what, a cool $10
million? First down.
Yeah, but you get a view of the playing field.
With binoculars.
5-yard penalty. It's now 1st and 10 on the 11. They had an ineligible receiver on the play. So with 24 seconds and 2 timeouts, Thomas goes to work. Hands to Peoples running left. Trojans knock him down. Clock runs. The loss of a yard on the play. Marshall, who's had a quiet first half, their junior middle linebacker.
Timeout.
And a timeout with 17 seconds left.
You know what was big?
Second timeout. Will be a 30-second timeout. Please set the game clock to 19 seconds. 19 seconds, please.
What was big?
The penalty saved a timeout a down, I should say, for App, because they were going to spike the football. It would be third down right now, but that was huge.
And that's Sean Clark talking with the field judge saying, my receiver's being held. You don't need to read the lips to understand what Sean's talking about on the previous play. Chip Lindsay, the coach of Troy, saying they're holding our guy.
You still have a timeout left. I mean, you can still run the ball. Really on second or third down here. But if you're Thomas, you can't take a sack. Here's this boy Hennigan right here in the slot. That's who we hit last time down here in the red zone.
Thomas, Everyone was covered. He airmails it through the goalposts. That's the third throwaway he's had, and that is the smart play. And with 14 seconds left, they'll have two more plays. By the way, how about the view in the end zone here, right?
Oh, it's beautiful.
That's Miller Hill.
Yeah.
That's where the fans sit when you're allowed to sit. Instead, they've got the cardboard cutouts that they have spelling out app.
Did he cross the previous play.
Did
he cross the line of scrimmage? Or is this on the defense? I couldn't tell. There's a lot of confusion.
Intentional grounding. Offense. Number 12. Spot foul. To avoid the 10-second runoff, Appalachian State is taking their final timeout.
Okay, so he threw it away, but I guess what? He's in the tackle box.
I guess it's...
They're showing here, right?
He
and there was no one there.
He actually gets outside the right tackle there. Cooper Hodges. So loss of down. They have to take the timeout because there would be a 10-second runoff. Go back and take a look at the tackle box. So here's your tackle box, right? As the play runs, let's see if he gets outside that line. Not even close, I don't think.
So the intentional grounding brings with it a loss of down. My sense is Sean Clark doesn't love the call, but you think it's the right call?
I think he was inside. I don't know that I've ever seen an intentional grounding like that, though, where you typically you're trying to throw it away to the sideline or something, but he just throws that through the goalpost. And I don't know. It was just kind of a strange, bizarre call.
Well, they have 14 seconds, and it's third down, so they've got one more play to run. And if they don't get the first down or touchdown, you would assume they'll try a field goal on the final play of the quarter. Thomas has thrown two touchdowns today, and now he looks for a third. It's an end around. And perhaps Williams is going to throw it. He is, but it's incomplete. They were going to try to throw the ball back to Zach Thomas on that play.
The old Philly special, right? Second time that they have run a reverse. This time they try to throw it. You see the reverse? He's definitely trying to pass it here, is Williams. And Williams, for a guy who's not a quarterback, very alert to throw that ball away, knowing... You don't have any timeouts left, and you just got 7 seconds. So you basically saved your team some points.
So Staten hit from 31 yards earlier. Moxholm hit second of the day with just 3 seconds to go, and App extends its lead to 34-10. Well, it wasn't an efficient drive at the end. They had an ineligible receiver. They had a drop, and they had a... Physical, intentional grounding penalty, but they get 3 out of it.
And they've got 34 points on the board. If you're App, you've got to be pretty happy with the score, the way your defense is played. Not the prettiest drive right there, as you mentioned, some of those miscues for the offense. But you've already reached, and this team comes in averaging 31 points per game.
At 1 second off the clock, and there'll be 2 seconds on the clock, and Troy will have time for one more play here at the end of the second quarter, either to A, take a knee, or B, throw it as far as you can.
I think at this point you take the D. Go to halftime and try to regroup. You can build on what your offense did in the second quarter. If your offense would have shown up in the first quarter, this would be a ball game right now.
Last play of the half now for Gunnar Watson. And they're going to run the football with Jamontez Woods, and that does it. Halftime in Boone. App State 34 and Troy 10, thanks to a big first quarter. The Mountaineers have the lead, a big lead here at the half. That's the story here from Boone. Now let's go to the studio. About the shot of the moon, by the way, from our cameraman, Dave Fields, and now at halftime, what happened?
Okay, so up top you'll see the A. That's the locker room. Okay, on the field, that's the players. They stayed in here at halftime, so they got to zip around here, go another, 200 yards to the locker room right there, and instead they decided to conserve the energy, and maybe has something to do with COVID, too, staying outside for the halftime, the whole duration of halftime, by the way, and here we go.
So, Coach Lindsay said, halftime adjustments? Heck, let's just stay on the field. We're going to have a team meeting. Now, he did meet with his assistants separately from the team, right? So the coaches all met together. Then they went and talked to the team, but they did it in that corner of the field.
And what was bizarre is some of the players had to, take a little restroom break at halftime. And they actually just kind of went up Miller Hill right behind the end zone and use the public restrooms at halftime with some of the fans that are in attendance.
That I have never seen before.
I thought that they were maybe going to go to the concession stand, snack some popcorn and a hot dog at halftime too.
So it's 2020, right? And that's what happens in 2020. Well, App State very, very rarely loses, particularly at home, and almost never in November. And even though they don't have a full house, and they would have had over 30,000 in here tonight if they were allowed.
Bill, you've been here for big games, of course, in your broadcasting career. This is my first trip to Boone.
Mm-hmm. What do you think?
It's the setting is unlike any other, no doubt about that. But I can't imagine what it would be like, what it would feel like to have a full house, and hopefully 2021 will serve us a little bit better.
This is one of the great stories in college football. This was a 1AA power, right? Won national championships, moved up to 1A, now called FBS, and App State has been dynamite since joining the SBC. And think about being great. How about these two dudes?
This is the dynamic duo this afternoon. The seniors, Williams and Zach Thomas. Thomas needs playmakers to step up on the outside, and really the last couple weeks, these seniors have. That's Malik Williams. Six catches, 93 yards, having himself a day.
So App State had over 330 yards in the first half. Let's see what Troy can do to try to slow him down here in the second. A first down throw for Thomas, flips it over to Hennigan, comes back to catch it near the 28, and he'll get wrestled to the ground there.
Very important drive here for this Troy defense. If they can just somehow get one stop, get your offense back on the field, let them build off of that momentum they had in the second quarter, you get this to 34-17. It could get real interesting real quick.
There goes Williams in motion. They run the football on second down, and Peebles gets about a yard or two. It'll bring up a third down.
App State's got to find a way to finish these ball games off. And Thomas has been terrific today. Efficient.
Remember a week ago he had, for him, a really bad day, a three-interception game at Coastal Carolina.
In the pick six to end the game, which was a fourth and 22, kind of a Hail Mary, but still was not a good throw.
Well, App was 7 of 9 on third downs in the first half. Troy just couldn't get off the field. Let's see if they can come up with a third down stop. They're in position. The ball comes free. And it rolls near the sideline. Shy of the first down.
Well, the question is, did the ball roll out before the stick? And I think it did. So this is going to be fourth and inches here, and they're going to punt. There's the strip at the end.
Robertson gets the strip. I think he was down, though,
I think
to be
he might have been down, too.
Regardless, he's down shy of the yard to make. And so
was he?
Xavier Sabach will punt.
Where was the ball? Like that was close, Bill. I'm surprised they're not going to take another look at that.
Sabach is the left-footed punter, and he kicks it high through the evening sky, and the fair catch taken on the 21-yard line by Tez Johnson. And so App goes three and out to start the second half, and that is huge for Troy. And they need something big out of this guy here in the third quarter, Gunnar Watson.
And he really got things going there in the second quarter. Ripped a couple beautiful passes into tight coverage, tight windows, and that's what this offense needs. Chip Lindsey needs out of his quarterback. By the way, I love your poet skills. I wanted to comment on that. As he kicks it high into the evening sky. Well done.
Thank you.
You're welcome.
He doesn't get to punt a whole lot.
No, he doesn't.
They score so many points. First down, here's a throw to Geiger. Penalty markers thrown. Geiger still on his feet, then knocked down hard near the 32-yard line. But I reckon this one's coming back, Dusty.
I think there's a hold on the outside. Or a potential chop block, even. You know it's on the offense as they're walking back. The flag was thrown right around where the ball was caught.
Illegal block below the waist. Number 29, offense. Has a distance to the goal. Replay the down.
So that's Orlando Lacy. He's the junior wide receiver. Let's take a look at what 29 does right here.
Right there. That's going to be the low block. Can't do that. Coming towards the line of scrimmage. So it negates a nice play on first down.
So the rule, an outside receiver, or if a team runs the triple option, you cannot block back inside.
That's correct.
Downfield back towards the line.
Correct.
Watson, a deep shot, and it is incomplete. Jolly, the corner, oof, nearly had the interception.
Well, he overshoots Reggie Todd on this one by about 3 yards, and Jolly nearly catches this. That's one that Jolly's going to want back. Really, it's kind of a poor decision by Watson. He's got two, three defenders around Todd down the field. I know he's taking a shot, but now you're, goodness, nearly have an interception in second and 20.
They keep it on the ground on second and very long, and nothing doing inside for Woods. And Trey Cobb came up again. He's been really good against the run. The junior from Waycross, Georgia, plays that inside linebacker position here for App State.
There's a reason that Trey Cobb leads the team in tackles. I mean, this guy is all over the place. We talked with Dale Jones. He said this guy is not just a good player, he's a great player.
Very instinctive. He knows, it seems, where the ball is going to go all the time. You don't have to necessarily follow the ball. Follow number 7. He'll take you there.
Screen.
And it's dropped by Woods, who turned to run before he caught it.
So that's devastating for the Troy offense. Your defense gets you off the field. Great stop on the third and short. Then you have a nice gain on first down, which is negated by a penalty, and the penalty just, it stalls the drive.
Yeah, once it was first and 20, that was it for that possession for Troy. Now, unfortunately for the Trojans, they're punting out of the end zone. That is Jack Martin, 43, the punter. This is a returnable kick for Williams. If he can field it on a hop, he lets it roll instead. Flags on the field, in fact, a couple of them. A couple behind the play as well. It'll roll dead to the 35-yard line. Let's see what the call is. Two flags on this punt.
Holding. Return team, number zero. Be 10 yards from the end of the kick. First down.
And so App State will get the ball back.
Trey Cobb, the App State defense. They love second and 20. And they love swarming the football.
Freshman quarterback T.J. Finley leads LSU into College Station to take on Kellen Mond and the number 5 Aggies. They're still in playoff contention. Catch it tonight on ESPN and the ESPN app. That beautiful moon will be in the air over College Station tonight, as well as it is here in Boone, North Carolina. First down throw, and Malik Williams, who is going to have a major, major night. That's his 7th catch. Another Mountaineer first down.
Boy, this guy is having himself a monster night. As we go back and look how efficient App State was throughout the first half. I mean, you talk about getting points on every drive. Yeah, they did it. Now they slowed down a little bit and just were held to field goals in the last couple, but still, you'll take that all day if you're Sean Clark.
Thomas hands it off this time to Noel. Bounces off one tackle, and Noel will surge for the first down. They'll give him forward progress all the way to the 44-yard line. There's that big, veteran, powerful offensive line getting it done.
Getting the push, and watch the cutback right there. The lane, you get a great block inside by Ryan Neusel. And then you see their center, the center, number 60, Noah Hannon, late there, pushing for the first down.
Thomas didn't have anyone open there, and he steps out of bounds. But positive yardage nonetheless, a pickup of 3 for Zach Thomas, 50-year senior, Trussville, Alabama. He has been the face of this App State program for the last couple of years. Two more scores tonight. He's got 64 in his career here. That ranks 3rd all-time in App State passing history. Seemingly goes to the right place every time with every throw, doesn't he? Thomas Boy. Hennigan makes that catch.
Hennigan is so reliable, you know, in these little short yardage situations. Kind of reminds me of, you know, look, any typical slot receiver for a quarterback. They're security blanket. He's comfortable. He knows that any time he throws to Hennigan in the flat, these short intermediate routes, he's so sure-handed.
They're at 70% on third down conversions tonight. Now 8 out of 11 as Noel runs to the 30-yard line.
86 is a great block right there in the center of the screen to help Noel pick up that first down. The redshirt sophomore.
They go two tight ends now and send Virgil in motion to the left. They're going to do a little smash mouth again with Noel, and he's down to the 25-yard line, a 5-yard pickup on first down for the freshman out of Miami's Northwestern High School.
And I kind of like what they're doing here with Noel, changing it up in the second half. You're allowing Cam Peoples, who got a pretty heavy workload in the first half, keep your running backs fresh as you're going to try and grind this game out with a 24-point lead here in the second half.
Second down and 5 against this Troy defense. They've been on the field a whole bunch today. Noel turns the corner, first down. He drops his shoulder right into Zion Williams, the corner on that play.
For a little dude, he brings some power. Watch the end of here. Little shimmy, and then tries to lower the shoulder. Like Mighty Mouse out there.
You know, he's 5'10", but he's a solid 175, 180.
Yeah.
They're in the red zone again. Noel running right. Noel cuts back, and he's wrestled down on the 8-yard line. KJ Robertson with the tackle of Noel. Well, it's working. Just keep giving it to the kid, huh?
Oh, and he makes it all happen, too. I mean, look how shifty he is. Once he gets to the second level, that's where he's most dangerous. We talked about that speed. He's got that big-time track speed that allows him to be that change of pace running back.
He's got 70 yards on 10 carries today. Here's carry number 11. And Noel has the first down on the one. It'll be first down and goal to go. Well, we're a month early, but the game plan here is Noel, Noel.
I love it. Watch the down block right there. You got your tight end. That's Henry Pearson doing a good job as Noel bounces outside.
They bring a fullback in on first down and goal. And somebody moved early.
False start. Offense, number 70. 5-yard penalty. Replay. First down.
That's the right tackle, Cooper Hodges. That'll move the ball to the 6. It will remain first down and goal.
You think that hair blocks his ears? From hearing the snap count,
I
love that though, man. That is a when you've got hair hanging out your helmet like that, and you play the way Cooper Hodges plays, which is nasty. That is intimidating, man. That's sweet.
He looks like an App State Mountaineer.
That's a great way to put it.
That's what you want. Thomas to the air, going to try to throw it back to the left. Touchdown. Henry Pearson, the tight end on the right, back to the left for the third passing touchdown for Thomas. And now Staden into attempt yet another point after, and this one dings off the upright. No good.
There's a flag. I think a little bit of pushing, a little frustration penalty after the snap.
They're looking over to the App bench, but let's see what the call is.
Result of the play, PAT is no good. After the play, unsportsmanlike conduct. Number 51, Appalachian State. The 15 yards will be assessed on the kickoff.
So we talked about Zach Thomas having to make some plays and to get back on track. I'd say they're back on track. 40-10 all over the Trojans.
Together tastes better. ESPN College Football, presented by Ally, is brought to you by Coca-Cola. Together tastes better.
App State leading Troy 40-10 here in the third quarter. It gets chilly this time of the year in the mountains of western North Carolina, but we got lucky. They've got Louisiana coming here in 6 days, next Friday. They're expecting 28 and snow on this field for the final home game.
Well, knowing my partner Bill Roth the way that I do, You are an absolute freeze baby from South Florida. That I'm pretty sure you're happy about the temperatures here today, Billy.
60 degrees. This time of year here, absolutely.
A Al's Nachos Party Pack. Delicious nachos topped with all your favorites. Only at Taco Bell.
Well, Troy had such an encouraging second quarter offensively. Gunnar Watson, that offense was really clicking. Ryan Pugh was saying, let's go fast. They moved up and down the field. But their first possession of the third quarter was a dud.
It really hurt them because had they been able to get that offense cooking again, they could have gone down the field and made it a 17-point game. Then you never know what could have happened at that point. But, boy, now be down 30.
Well, we know the ball's going to be in the air, and Watson's pass batted down. He was trying to connect with Clark, and it was batted down. It might have been Demetrius Taylor that got his hands up on it.
Talked about Taylor early in the ballgame, our Ally player to watch. And we're watching him make a lot of plays.
He's also from Miami Northwestern High School. Second down and 10. This is Jamontez Woods, and it will be third down and 10. Well, this has been a rough time for Troy. You know, the COVID hit them late. Some teams got banged early. Some teams, got through it even in the preseason. Troy got affected in the last couple of weeks, including their head coach. Three members of the coaching staff were out last week. They've had three games rescheduled or postponed. But now it's hurting them in terms of personnel, and you can kind of sense it.
Oh, you kind of sensed it in Chip's voice when we talked to him last night. They're just dealing with it. It's one of those things. Got a penalty here pre-snap. But back to your point about the COVID in 2020, look, everyone's dealing with something.
False start. Offense. Number 77. 5-yard penalty. Replay. You
know, imagine being a player. And you're going to practice every day. Take a look at the false start here. It's going to be your right tackle. Yep, just a little early. Just to pay that off, it's the players, the uncertainty of knowing if you're going to play the game, and then imagine showing up to a stadium and then being told like 2 hours before kickoff the game is off and you've prepared all week for that opponent and the coaches, the amount of hard work, and they're still dealing with it, grinding through.
They try to set up the little screen. And they got about 8 of it back on 3rd and 15. And DeMarco Jackson came over to make the play. Troy's kids, they actually bust up a day early. They came up on Thursday. Yeah. They bust all the way from Troy to Hickory, North Carolina. They had their Thanksgiving dinner as a group,
which is
on Thursday night.
A great thing. I saw the video Troy put out. It was fantastic. When you can't be with your families on Thanksgiving, I should say, there's nothing better than your football family. And the players got to have their fellowship and have their turkey dinner.
Here is the punt. Big roll all the way to the 25-yard line. And Williams will step out of bounds. Late in the third, here in the mountains of North Carolina, App State leads 40-10. We've given up on Dustin, and this is my new analyst, Yosef, the longtime and beloved Appalachian State mascot, has joined us here in the booth here in the third quarter.
You like that?
I do.
I found that in the back of the broadcast booth, and obviously the cardboard cutouts are a huge part of all sports in 2020. So Yosef couldn't make it, so I had to fill in.
On Miller Hill, the players, some former players have bought cardboard cutouts. Some of the App State alums and students have purchased similar cardboard cutouts. Some country music stars have cardboard cutouts. They're on Miller Hill. So I know the people are showing their faces. They're likely watching the game somewhere. So in a way, you are on Miller Hill.
That's right. Virtually. Now, this is one of my favorite country artists. There's Luke Combs at an App State game back in 2008. And we know he's a huge Mountaineer fan, along with Eric Church, another country legend that is an alum of App State. Love their music.
Great, great country music from this part of North Carolina. Kids grow up here. They support it. App State has a really good music program.
Yeah. No doubt.
That was another App State first down ahead to the 36-yard line by Cameron Peoples. Last year he had that season-ending knee injury. Well, there you go.
There's Mr. Combs hanging out with the fans on Miller Hill. He's got a heck of a beard now, that Luke Combs. He's grown it out since college quite a bit.
Right?
Yeah.
I mean, that's the App State thing, man. You've got to have that beard going like, you know, Cooper Hodges has his going. In open space, here goes Christian Horn on the move inside the 20. And the freshman from Columbia, South Carolina, has App knocking on the door once again.
Christian Horn, just a true freshman. Boy, is he long at 6'2", rangy, still a little bit raw for a wide receiver, but man, you can see the speed of the young, talented wide receiver.
Peebles puts it on the ground, and let's see who comes up with it. The linesman says App recovers, and that's going to be the case. Second down.
Take a look at this, the play action pass, great protection in the pocket. He just sits down in the zone, and you're going to have a missed tackle right there by Josh Brown, another freshman, DB, playing for Troy. You know, they said to us, Christian Horn, he's going to be a good one. And they've got a couple young players, Christian Wells, along with Horn.
Horn and Deshaun Davis.
Davis as well. Yeah, all freshmen.
All three freshmen. All three have caught a ball today. Second down and 8. Here's Noel. And he's down to the 5-yard line as we near a minute 30 to go here in the third. It will bring up a third and goal. That was Carlton Marshall, who's been the leading tackler here today for Troy, making that play.
Are you surprised we haven't seen Cam Peoples here in the second half? Especially in a situation like this, the short yardage. Still got his helmet on the sidelines. It's a little bit surprising. Maybe they're just kind of going with the hot hand because Noel's been pretty effective.
That he has. The line shifts right before the snap. And he's going to try to run as Zach Thomas. Can he make it to the pylon? Uh-uh. Well, they shifted the tight ends and the line all a step to the right. And they said, Zach, see if you can make it. Run to the left pylon, but he couldn't get there in time. And that was Reddy Stewart that tracked him down.
I think App's just going to keep their offense on the field.
Fourth and goal. Two tight ends on the right.
Nothing fancy here.
Thomas, that is his fourth touchdown of the game. Caleb Sperlin, who starts at defensive end, also comes in as a goal line fullback. And the starting defensive end, the senior from Galax, Virginia, has a touchdown reception.
This guy was a former walk-on. Great leader on this defense. He's developed into an awesome player.
Second touchdown reception of the year for Caleb Sperlin's defensive end slash goal line receiver.
Take a look here. Here's Sperlin in the backfield. He's just going to leak out here. And there's nobody that's going to stay with him. An easy pitch and catch on fourth and goal. Now, Sperlin, you can tell he doesn't get to the end zone very often. Whoop! A little slippery there.
Look at that grin.
Nonetheless, I think they're pretty happy.
Caleb Sperlin is living his best life. It's 47-10.
You know, he had a rushing touchdown last year against Texas State.
All I know is that ball in 15 years will be on a mantle or in a trophy case, and he's going to be able to tell his kids how he sprinted 81 yards for a touchdown. Here's another kickoff for App State, and fair catch called for with 17 seconds left. Well, Dusty, our next UFC Fight Night is tonight in Las Vegas. Curtis Blaydes, he's the second-ranked heavyweight contender. He's taking on Derek Lewis, the number four contender. It'll be a slugfest main event. The prelims start at 7 Eastern on ESPN+. The main card's at 10 Eastern. You can catch it, everybody, on ESPN, ESPN Deportes, and ESPN+, in both English and in Spanish.
We've got a new quarterback in the game. That's going to be Parker McNeil. Billy?
Jacob Free, who is ordinarily the backup, not here tonight. So McNeil comes on in relief of Watson on what will likely be the final play of the third quarter. And the period comes to an end. Well, a week after losing on the road in a game in which it wasn't sharp, the opposite through three quarters tonight for the App State Mountaineers. They have been efficient. They have been explosive. And in front of their home fans in Boone, here at The Rock, Appalachian State, a 47-10 lead as we head to the fourth. You're watching college football on ESPN, presented by Ally Bank. Bill Roth, Dustin Fox in Boone, North Carolina on this late November evening. It has been all App State. Let's see if Troy can make a rally in the fourth quarter. And that's not a good start, is it? There's McNeil again playing in place of Jacob Free, the freshman from Alabama who is not here tonight. And McNeil misfired on that throw.
This guy was a JUCO college transfer, was the player of the year back in 2019. 56 touchdown passes this guy threw. That's a lot. So, good to see his first action here this season.
Third down for McNeil. App rushes 3, drops 8. And that's deflected and nearly picked off again. Ryan Huff had his hands on it. The junior free safety for App State.
It's a pretty good throw. Kind of in the bucket between the corner and the safety over top. That's cover 2 they're playing, Bill. And Huff thought he had a pick. But we're going to see that App State offense one more time.
Jack Martin will punt it away for Troy to Malik Williams. And he angles it away from Williams, and it takes a good Troy roll down to the 26-yard line. We'll step aside. App State with the big lead here in the fourth. Wow, thanks, Kevin. Meanwhile, here, the route is on as well in Boone. And how about Zach Thomas? Malik Williams has been the big story with a career high of 713 yards receiving, but 9 different receivers today.
Well, one of my keys to the game was for Zach Thomas to get back to being Zach, right? Be the efficient quarterback that everyone here in Boone remembers, the 29-5 starter. He'll win his 30th game today.
They keep it on the ground on first down, and look at this run. All the way to the 25-yard line. Well, tremendous run.
Anderson Castle is a true freshman, going to come wide open out of a huge hole on the left side.
He looked like Mike Allstott running down the field.
Well, how about Larry Zonka? That's who they compared him to. This is a guy they just moved over recently from linebacker on defense, just to kind of provide some depth because they've got so many injuries in the backfield. That was pretty impressive.
Castle brings it to the 25-yard line. Jacob Huseman is the quarterback in relief of Thomas. They give it to Castle again, and this time Carlton Marshall brings him down. There's Huseman. He's out of Bradenton, Florida. He could start for a lot of teams. I mean, that's what happens when you sit behind a guy like Zach Thomas.
He's a fifth-year guy, and Sean Clark loves him because he's stuck it out. Like, a lot of players, as you mentioned, not getting to play, they hit the portal. You know, they go to other places. This guy loves Boone. He loves his teammates. He loves Zach Thomas. They're best of friends. So it's a great feel-good story for Huseman.
Castle on the cutback. Gets the ball near the 20-yard line. By the way, second year in a row that Zach has thrown four touchdowns against Troy. That ties his career high. And he moved into fourth place on the all-time passing list here. But his day's done.
Yeah.
So they're going to go with Huseman the rest of the way. And Zach gets to trade positions. He gets to signal in plays.
See,
wear a baseball cap.
He's been hitting some home runs there today.
Third down for Huseman. Castle up the middle, and he runs into Carlton Marshall again. They push him back. It'll be fourth down. Marshall now has 13 tackles today to lead Troy. By the way, if you look closely at his shoe, see closely there how it's untied? That's a tradition that goes all the way back to high school. He leaves his left shoe, actually his right shoe. It's actually his right shoe tonight. Right shoe untied. He did that his freshman year, had a big game in high school, and so that has been a tradition to leave one shoe untied throughout the entire game.
I'm very superstitious as well, but I just don't know how I could play with my shoe untied in terms of the support.
He's got 13 tackles today. Make it 14. A fourth down stop for number two. And they get off the field. Good job for the junior from Mobile. Troy gets the stop.
ESPN College Football is presented by Ally. Make your money work smarter with Ally.
All right, let's take a closer look at the offensive line for App State. Pocket protection brought to you by Nationwide.
Cole Garrison, Ryan Neusel, Noah Hannon, Bear Hunter, gotta love that name, Cooper Hodges, the right tackle. The amount of time that Zach Thomas has had to throw today has been incredible. Much different than last week in the second half. They have kept their quarterback upright, and Zach Thomas has had himself a monster afternoon.
McNeil on first down, hands the football off. What is it like when you are in a game like this on the losing side? You played at Ohio State very rarely. I'll even ask you, did you have any games where you were on this side of the score, a lopsided score?
Yeah, 2003. It was my, no, 2004, excuse me, my senior year at Ohio State.
Yeah.
We went on the road to Iowa City, and the Hawkeyes just beat us down. Just absolutely beat the brakes off of us. And by the time this, I mean, it was like 37 to 10 or 7, I don't know, something like that. I mean, it was, you know, a 30-point blowout. It was one of my only blowouts I was a part of at Ohio State.
So what do you, as a coach, learn about your team and your leadership and the attitude of your guys, not only on the field but on the sideline in a lopsided game like this? How can this be a teaching moment for Chip and his team?
As you get a new quarterback in here for Troy, to finish our thoughts there, Bill, it is one of those situations where as a coach, you want to see how guys finish games. And if you're a younger player that gets an opportunity to come in a ball game like this, they want to see how you perform because, listen, you're thrown into the fire late in the game and you got another quarterback coming in here. That's going to be Kyle Toole, the true freshman.
His first action, Kyle Toole. He was a gentleman out of Leesburg, Georgia. You know, he was 40-4 in high school and went to several state titles in Leesburg.
Impressive resume for the young quarterback. Great prep by you having the fifth-string quarterback down. You are diligent in your prep, my friend.
But if you're a high school quarterback, this is the kind of guy that Chip Lindsey wants in his program. A kid who won in high school, A. B, a smart kid, C, within about a six-hour circumference of Troy. That's the kind of kid they want.
There are so many great players in the state of Alabama. To be able to, as you say, kind of get that circumference, the six-hour radius, that is the perfect area to target. And they think they've got a pretty good one here at Toole.
That'll be enough for the first down. Yeah, they've done well in recruiting, by the way. You know, they're really happy with their kids that they've got. They like to, I mean, you talked about Reddy and Pettis on the defense. They're North Alabama kids, right?
Yeah.
They've got, I looked at it, they've got two running backs committed from Alabama. 17 commitments already for next year. Now, the decision that Chip Lindsey and all coaches are going to have to make is a kid can come back, right? A senior can come back next year.
This year doesn't technically count.
But you can only have 85 total next year.
And that's where the question comes in, the tough decisions that these coaches have to make. What do you say to a fifth-year guy? Here's Tool. Welcome to college football, young man. Takes a pretty good shot there from the App State defense. As we're going down the depth chart, T.D. Roof makes the stop.
Second down for Kyle Toole. Hands the football off. This is Charles Strong. He started his career at Texas A&M. He was an Aggie that transferred over. He'll be watching his former teammates, no doubt, on
offside.
The bus.
Defense, number 37, 5-yard penalty.
You know who?
Replay, second down.
Against, they play LSU later tonight, I'm sorry.
You remember the cousin of Charles Strong?
Tell me.
Played football at Florida in the NFL for a brief period of time, but it's a silver medalist in the Olympics in 2012. How about that? You know who it is? Jeff Demps.
Jeff Demps, go Gators. Boy, you are pulling out some serious intel tonight. But for Charles Strong and his family, this is a chance to play. He's got fresh legs. He doesn't care what the score is. He's running hard. And he runs for a first down. Good job by Strong. It is a strong run for Charles.
Well said. And he's another one of these young running backs that's getting an opportunity in this game because of all the COVID issues that we've had in college football. There's a few players that were left behind this weekend in Troy that didn't make it. And they're a little bit thin in the running back room. Just looking forward to seeing Vidal play in this game. And unfortunately, he's out.
But Dusty, isn't this what you were just talking about when you're down 47-10 as a coach or even as a Troy fan? Who on the field right now is still going as hard as you can? And that's that offensive line and Strong again, putting his head down.
Yeah, you mean, listen, you want to see who finishes the game. And a player like Strong, running hard, getting an opportunity, those things get noticed. Watch, there's going to be five players that have to bring down Strong. There's one, still stays up. Two, three, four, five. And, like, I think a sixth guy tried to jump in to get an aggressive J.O.P.
So he gets his look at his teammates. They recognize the effort he gave.
Absolutely.
This is a very proud program at Troy. They've won a lot of games in this league, a lot of games over the years. This score is somewhat of an outlier.
This whole season's been an outlier, especially for a team like Troy. I mean, they played Middle Tennessee State twice. That never happens in college football.
And they weren't even on the schedule to begin with. That's a gain of seven, but we've got a flag on the play.
Away from the play.
D.K. Billingsley is out of Scottsboro, Alabama, redshirt freshman. But here's the call.
Offside, defense, number 48, 5-yard penalty. Replay, second down.
See right there at the bottom of your screen.
Defensive end jumped.
Yeah, it's Chris Washington, 46. Getting himself a little bit of action here late in the ballgame.
Second down and four. Billingsley going to try to pop it outside. And he's shoved down by Tommy Wright.
That's a pretty good tackle for App State. Tommy Wright at the corner. That's how you get off a block. You come up, you get your helmet in front, Bill, and you wrap, and you drive those legs, especially on a big-time running back that's got you in terms of size, a little bit bigger than you. Tommy's just a true freshman as well.
And he's been playing behind Shamar Jean Charles, so he's learned a lot over the years. But next year.
No question.
Right? Next year.
Well, Jean Charles is probably going to the National Football League.
Yeah. So that's my point. So Tommy Wright is a guy that's going to be getting all the first team reps in practice starting in the spring. Draw play on third down. And knocked down shy of the first down. It'll be fourth down with 5:30 to go. That was T.D. Roof again making the play. He's been in on a bunch of tackles here in the second half for App. Fourth and one, they're going to bring B.J. Smith back into the game, it appears. And Troy will go for it on fourth down. It's really fourth and about a foot for the Trojans.
Yeah, Roof knows a little bit something about defense's dad. The D.C. at Vanderbilt. You always love coaches' sons when you recruit. Because
why is that?
They tend to have a different type of DNA. When you grow up around a coach, you're pushed a little bit harder, I think.
I know Ted was the head coach at Duke. He was at Georgia Tech. Longtime assistant there and head coach. Fourth down and a foot. And he's got the first down. But a flag is thrown on the play. And here's the call.
Personal foul. Face mask. Defense. Number 43. 15 yards at the end of the run. First down.
Let's take a look at the left tackle on this play for App State.
And right here. Oh, it looks like the defender gets his hands in the face. It's Austin Stidham, still in the game. Stidham's the star left tackle, one of the best in the conference.
So they'll move the football to the 27-yard line for Troy. So a glimpse of the future in Troy with this true freshman quarterback. Billingsley. They'll give him forward progress to the 24 with 4:14 to go. App State will get ready to play Louisiana here on Friday. For Troy, their game's against South Alabama and Monroe were moved to new dates. Coastal's coming up. They got them on December 12th. A lot of football left. For really both of these teams.
Anything stand out to you?
For which one?
For App.
Yeah.
Well, Coastal had the big win today over Texas State.
Right, so they're going to clinch the division. In Louisiana here on Friday, maybe in the snow. Can you imagine this place on Friday if it's snowing?
I'll come back if they call.
You want to come back?
I'll come back. Can you imagine? Sean Clark's house.
Kidding. Better have four-wheel drive.
Yeah.
Yeah, the weather here tonight was great. Well, coming up tonight on ESPN, we've been talking about this game for a while. I am really excited about this one. LSU at Texas A&M. Remember last year? This was 50-7. That was in Baton Rouge. Tonight we are in Aggieland at 7 o'clock on ESPN and the app.
Should be a good one.
Oh, Jimbo's been ready for this one, I assure you. The Aggie Nation
and LSU,
is ready.
You're trying to replace Joe Burrow is impossible. and certainly they're having some issues in Baton Rouge.
Billingsley gets a couple of yards down to the 19-yard line.
Have you called a game in Death Valley?
Yeah, I've been in both Baton Rouge, tonight's games
in College Station.
Yeah,
both places.
Done games in both places.
Man.
Wonderful home field advantages, great places, wonderful fans. Love them both.
Well, they have some. The SEC has fans. I mean, they've got like 20,000 or something, 20% capacity. College Station, that matters. That's a huge advantage.
Great traditions at A&M.
The 12th man.
We'll get there some night.
The Yell Leaders.
Fourth down. Let's see if Troy can keep this drive going with its freshman quarterback. Billingsley has the first down. This is what I'm talking about. Those are hard yards to get. Billingsley saying that I want to play. They've They've held the ball for, what, 10 minutes?
Yeah, this drive's been nearly 10 minutes, Billy.
Starting with Strong and now running the ball, remember, and now Billingsley. Nothing's easy.
No, give him credit. And if you're Troy, you'd love to get a touchdown here just to make you feel a little bit better with your backups and getting on that bus. Long bus ride home, by the way. I think they're a little happy this game got moved up to 3:30.
Freshman going to get knocked down by 1, 2, 3 players with a minute 23 to go.
You know what else, Billy, is if you're Sean Clark, look at the way these guys are flying around, too. They're backups on defense.
Well, coming up Tuesday at 7 Eastern, 4 Pacific on ESPN and the app, we have the exclusive reveal of the college football playoff top 25 rankings. Reese and the guys will break it down from all the way at the top to the bottom, coaches' reaction and more with committee chairman Gary Barta, the University of Iowa athletic director. I want to hear about the Buckeyes and what they think about Ohio State.
Tuesday is going to be very interesting to see how they are treating the situation with cancellations, frankly. I mean, if Ohio State, what if they only play four games? Do they hold them out? Now, there is an interesting tight ball game going on ESPN right now. Northwestern and Michigan State tied at 20 apiece.
There's a lot of drama in the Big Ten. Clock turning now. We're under 25 seconds to play. Third down for the Troy Trojans. Trying to get in the end zone here. Maybe one last helping of something to taste good on this Thanksgiving week. This has been a rough day for the Trojans, quite obviously. That's going to be shy of the first down, and it's going to be the final play of the game.
What a way for the Mountaineers to bounce back after a tough, tough loss a week ago in Myrtle Beach against Coastal Carolina. And they come right back home in front of, give or take, 2,000 fans, and they are happy to see their Mountaineers back in the win call.
Final score here today, App State 47 and Troy 10. We'll go to the studio, get all the latest coming up after the break.